Got room for one more?
This here is Daisy Domergue. She's wanted dead or alive for murder. When that sun comes out, I'm taking this woman to hang.
Well, well, well. Looks like Minnie's haberdasher is about to get cozy for the next few days.
Yes, it does.
While racing towards the town of Red Rock in post-Civil War Wyoming, bounty hunter John the Hangman Ruth, played by Kurt Russell, and his fugitive prisoner, played by Jennifer Jason Leigh, encounter another bounty hunter, Samuel L. Jackson, and a man who claims to be a sheriff. Hoping to find shelter from a blizzard, the group travels to a stagecoach stopover located in a mountain pass. Greeted there by four strangers, the eight travelers soon learn that they may not make it to their destination after all. And that is the synopsis for the latest film by Quentin Tarantino. I believe, is that the eighth or ninth movie? Eighth, yes. Okay. The eighth film by Quentin Tarantino, The Hateful Eight, which released last winter, I believe. And we just watched it, and we're going to, well, we're going to talk about it, examine it, and sort of look at what stuff is going on with, you know, things like gender, and also maybe look at what the critics had to say about it. So, first off, I guess we're going to look at what we thought about the movie, just in general. So, I'll start, just because I'm already talking. I actually really liked this film, and it was a, you know, I'm not crazy about all of Tarantino's movies, like I'm not like a crazy fanboy, but I think that he does good work more about half the time, and then the other half, it's never, like, he doesn't have any bad movies, save for Death Proof, I wasn't crazy about, but the other stuff is all good. But this was one of the ones that I put higher up. I thought it was, there was a lot more interesting things going on in it than, say, something like Django Unchained or the Inglourious Bastards, which I thought they were good movies too. But this one really, I don't know, I think this is one of his better films, in my opinion. And I like the old Western, the great score by Sergio Leone. I believe he won an Oscar for that. And of course he was known for doing the Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, and lots of other sort of spaghetti westerns of the time. And of course all the performances are good. I love Kurt Russell. I just love him. I love Jennifer Jason Leigh. She was I didn't realize this until I was watching The Hudsucker Proxy the other day, but she was in that, and she was actually my favorite character in that film, just because of the way that she acts. She's just really good. So I enjoyed it. Max, what did you think?
You know, Quentin Tarantino, he has a very, you know, it's sort of the most obvious thing about him. He has a very distinct style compared to that of other filmmakers. He likes to draw upon films from the past. You know, he's very, very bloody. I would almost like to call his entire catalog of films the Kool-Aid Saga for all the blood that's in them. But anyways, when it comes to The Hateful Eight, I would say that his sort of signature formula of sort of resting on a slow-paced burn leading up to this ultimate bloody exciting climax didn't work for me personally as well in this movie as it did for the rest of his catalog of films. Now, don't get me wrong, like Brian said, he hasn't really done a bad movie save for Death Proof, although I would have to say that The Hateful Eight for me personally is probably my least favorite, because while that slow burn to that sort of climax did work in some very, very brilliant scenes in this movie, it almost seems like there wasn't a payoff for a movie that runs almost 3 hours long, at least when it comes to certain elements of the film. But overall, I would say that I enjoyed it. Obviously, like you said, anytime that Kurt Russell is on screen, I am absolutely captivated. I'm enthralled. Love Jennifer Jason Leigh. I love all the people in this movie. It's a great cast. Tim Roth is the man. Sam L. Jackson, anytime that he's paired up with Quentin Tarantino, it's absolute magic. It's great score. Obviously deserved to win the Oscar. And whenever you're looking at the outdoor shots of this movie, it's absolutely gorgeous to look at. So while I would say that I would, you know, recommend a movie like Kill Bill or Inglourious Bastards or Django Unchained above this movie, I would still say it's worth the watch, because you know, there are some interesting explorations of, you know, humankind and the nature of evil and the depths of villains that I think are, you know, it might hit people in a lot more positive light than it did for me. So I recommend it.
All right. And Anna, what did you think?
And now for something completely different. I mean, unpopular opinion time, I guess, as always. Not a Tarantino fan at all. The only movies I've seen of his... Well, okay, I started watching Pulp Fiction and gave up on it in the middle. And I said, I'll probably watch it some other time. I should probably take a nap instead. So it really didn't do it for me at all. Kill Bill was, you know, fun. I think that's the only one I've ever seen of his movies all the way through and really enjoyed it. Real quick note, seeing Reservoir Dogs stars Tim Roth and that other guy who played the cowboy, Joe...
Michael Madsen.
Right.
And seeing that relationship and the fact, and of course, some of the other actors that Tarantino habitually uses in all of his movies, and seeing them all coming together as a gang member for some reason gave me an echo as to what I've seen of Reservoir Dogs. And it finally gave me a reason to actually watch that because I've had that downloaded sitting in my computer for years and I've been working up the psyching myself up to watch it and just couldn't really do it because I don't know, just Tarantino doesn't do it for me. However, I would say that this is absolutely his best movie ever. I loved every fucking second of it. It could be because I'm a huge weird Western fangirl. It's one of those genres that just didn't sit well with me for the longest time until I saw Tombstone, I believe, and then played Red Dead Redemption, and that together, that immersive experience into the cowboy Western world, and also with some mind read stuff that I read as a kid, just kind of came back to me, and I was like, whoa, I really love Westerns. So it really was juicily glorious from that perspective, the way this movie was made. And to me, it was the least Tarantino movie I've ever seen, and I loved that. Of course, the gushing, ridiculous blood that's like, okay, you gotta do your, like, From Dawn Till Dusk. I think I've seen that one, too. You gotta do that thing with the blood and the gore. Sure, whatever. It still doesn't top what Caligula was in gore, so I'm okay. The bar for gore hasn't been violated for me in this one.
It also didn't top Caligula for blowjobs.
No, not even close. Not even a little. But that was a very vivid scene. He is an imaginative person, Samuel Jackson's character. Anyway, I was not going to use the entire quote from the movie, although I think if we delve into the racism racist language of the movie, we might have to use some of these terms. But anyway, back to my feelings in the movie, it was awesome. And I love the attention to detail of the realism in that sense of living in that frontier times and being in the blizzard. And the fact that, like landscape, Max mentioned, you couldn't even see how amazing the landscape was because it was all blizzarded up. And you had to, you know, make the stake of rope thingies all the way to the outhouse and back because, and then nail the door shut because these were real. And the coffee was terrible. I mean, these were real live things that people dealt with back in the day. And yeah, all the performances were particularly good. The villainess, she was deliciously loathsome. And of course, for some reason, somehow Kurt Russell, who I didn't care about or think he could act at all, he was just one of those like 80s blue-eyed guys that just disappeared into obscurity. Suddenly he did the Jeff Bridges thing where he got some, you know, mustache and like mutton chops and gray hair, and bam, he's like amazing at acting suddenly. You're like, what is this? So Kurt Russell's character was awesome, absolutely my favorite. Utterly enjoyed that. Very good, all of it. I'm gonna fangirl about this, which is odd because I'm not a Tarantino fan, and this movie was everything that Tarantino is not, and so I really appreciate the fact that he can. Well, I mean, not everything he's not, but in a large way, it's not his style, it's not his pace. Nothing was what I would expect of a Tarantino movie, other than the when they were vomiting blood. And I loved it, and I'm surprised and proud that he could do this. It shows creative acumen and talent, and yeah, go Tarantino. Good job. Well done.
All right. I have to speak to a couple of things that you said before we move on. First off, Tombstone, fucking awesome. It's a good fucking movie. I love Tombstone. And another Kurt Russell vehicle. So yes, Tombstone, mwah, great. Was the best thing that Val Kilmer ever did.
Fuck is, yes, yes, God gave movie. Me the appreciation yeah. for Val Kilmer like I never had before. It was like, oh, that movie, yes, mwah, that, exactly. Yeah.
Oh, dude, have you ever seen Top Secret?
Yeah, Top Secret's awesome. I love it. And Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. Oh, very, yeah. He's good in that too. But I don't know, man. His Doc Holliday. That's it, man. That's Val Kilmer. That's what's gonna be in his gravestone. Like,
it's, I guess, I need, like, to watch.
Here lies yeah. Doc Holliday. Like, that's his best role. Like, everybody's,
I've never
favorite.
Seen Tombstone. I guess I gotta get on that.
Oh, you gotta watch it. And
oh wait,
to go back to
just real quick, once oh, we're, yeah. since we're throwing in movie names, I forgot one more that was somewhat important in this development of Western love for me, and it was not as good, but I guess that's where I got my appreciation for slowness of what this movie was, which I didn't think it was slow at all. It was a very intense psychological drama in a way. To me, it was very much like a reimagining of Clue, and like, it's like Game of Thrones and Clue in the Western world.
Good call.
Yeah, so that was good, and I enjoyed that. But the other one that was good-ish, not as good as Tombstone, but what was it called? The Murder of... what's his face by the Howard...
Yes,
that one.
But I think it's The Murder of Jesse James by
yes,
the Coward...
Yes, Coward Robert Ford.
Yeah, Robert Ford, that's right, yes. That was, I believe that's a Brad Pitt movie. Yeah. I actually never saw it. The thing is, too, with the slowness of the Hateful Eight, which, you know, Anna's spot on about, it does, it's like they introduce, and this is what Tarantino is known for doing, he makes so many interesting characters, each one of them very individualistic, and he puts them in a film, and it, I mean, if you look at all of his movies, they have that, even like the guys from Reservoir Dogs are like individuals, and they're all really interesting, and they might have like nicknames or something they're known for, and it's often stuff that's pretty... You know, they have dark, grisly pasts or something not quite right, or they're shady characters or whatever. And then he thrusts them into a situation and you're expecting something a bit more like knockdown, drag out, you know, action. But I think that what he was going for, because he is a filmmaker who's also a film fan. He loves movies and he makes movies. So you can see that in his stuff. Everything is derivative and there's homages and there's a lot of that in a lot of his work. And so I think that with The Hateful Eight, what he was doing was what was also very common with old Westerns of like the period when Westerns were really popular, like 70s, 60s or whatever. And that was often films that were very, very long, like really long, because oftentimes they were inspired by samurai films, which were also really, really long, and they didn't have a lot of action. It was all about build up, tension, build up. And then there'd be something at the end, like a payoff. Now, the degree to which the payoff was would match your expectations based on what was being built up, that might, you know, that your mileage may vary. But I think that's what he was going for. And of course, if you throw in like the score that he was using, and then the way he filmed it, which was, I believe it's Panavision 70. It was like extra wide shots, which were very popular for filming these old Westerns where you get like these big picturesque, you know, landscape shots. But he does this thing, which I find really interesting, and I'm gonna throw it in there. One, he does it during the winter, which is weird because Westerns are not usually done that way. They're usually done in the deserts, in the mountains, and in the warmer time of the year. You don't often see it take place around that time. And it's usually during the day as well. So you get like as much visual eye candy of, you know, this sort of Western America as possible. And he chooses to do it in the winter time, which limits what you're gonna see. And so you actually have less of it. And then on top of that, which I think is even stranger, is that he chooses to shoot most of the film indoors.
That's a 3 hour of... 3 hour visit at a lodge, or what was it, the 3 hours at a cabin. But yeah, I think maybe a hats off to or a tip of the hat to Revenant, things like that with the wintry landscapes. But yeah, it's completely the action is missing in the conventional sense from this movie. It is entirely a psychological action. The entirety, well, I mean, there's the shooting, but the entirety of action or the excitement is in the mystery, not in horses and riding around and being in a typical action Western.
Yeah. And because it's shot indoors, and as I was watching it the second time, I was thinking about this. I used to work in theater before I started doing Honey Badger Radio full time, right? And I've seen a lot of plays. And when you're watching a play, the actors, you could have several actors and the ensemble doing stuff at the same time, and you're kind of, as a viewer, you could choose to focus on what one person is doing, especially during a sequence where there's a lot of people doing a lot of things. And you could follow people around the stage, especially if it's a wider one. And the reason why I say that is because in many ways, this felt like a stage play.
No, it's a really good point. And in fact, I heard something about when I first learned about this movie, and it gave me curiosity to see it, was that it was written as a form of Broadway. Now, I'm not sure if I understood that incorrectly, or that they were specifically saying that not only does it resemble it, it was specifically written as a Broadway thing. And in fact, it might be a reimagining of a Japanese work, or am I completely confused? I don't know. But I think you're completely right. And I think they played it up as well in terms of their camera angles. Multiple times they were doing that. It would be a wide shot when, for instance, Demagu was playing the guitar later in the second half, and you saw people walking around behind her and drinking the coffee. That was, spoilers, poisoned. And before that, there were other scenes of people moving around in the background, like especially Bob, the Mexican, and other things like that in the background that they would preferentially focus on, either people in the foreground or the background, so you could basically keep an eye on absolutely everyone. And that one stage basically setup is very much like plays are done, where you rely heavily on, acting talent in order to deliver and to sell you on the imagery instead of using CG or actual locations to immerse you. You just have the actors on one flat stage, which is essentially what that cabin was.
Yeah. So I know, I thought that it was, that's, when I really think of it in that way, when you think about and compare it to other Tarantino stuff, in many ways, actually, Hateful Eight feels a good deal like Reservoir Dogs, because in Reservoir Dogs, they also, the majority of the film takes place in one spot.
The warehouse.
And the warehouse, yeah. Right. And it's just, characters come and go and all that, but you see it in mostly in one location, and you just watch everything unfold slowly over time. So, anyway, and there is a reveal in Reservoir Dogs. By the way, for those of you guys who are watching, yes, we can't talk about this movie without spoilers, so you're gonna either have to watch the movie first, or you can deal with the spoilers, or you could just, choose to not watch the movie and just listen to this. So whatever works. All right. So I guess let's get into the gender stuff, because this film created a lot of hubbub around the violence that was enacted upon Jennifer Jason Leigh's character, Daisy Domergue. For whatever reason, it was seen as there was violence against women, was violence against her, and was visited upon her several times. And even from the moment she's first introduced, she already has a black eye and other injuries from likely from her struggle with the hangman, John Ruth, trying to basically take her prisoner.
Hey, you ain't really gonna let that nigger ride in here, is you? I mean, maybe up there with OB, but...
How you like the sound of them bells, bitch? What the...
Is that the way niggas treat their ladies?
You ain't no goddamn place!
So, when you guys watch the movie, I'll give it to Anna first. Do you think that the idea that this is a special case of violence against women, do you think that this is a special case for that? Like that these people that are saying this are on the money? Or do you think that there's something else at work that makes people react that way?
Yawn on that argument.
Yeah.
No, it's, well, if you consider Tarantino's previous work and you look at something like Kill Bill, imagery which I like to use for some of my Tropes versus Men background shots, is that this is actually if you take equality of sexes being the definition of feminism, this is a very feminist film from Tarantino because, as they say, you gotta, you know, hang mean bastards and mean bastards gotta hang. And she's a mean bastard and they're giving equal opportunity of being a villain and a hero to women in different movies. So very feminist movie in that sense, if we take feminism being the equality of the sexes. Now, if we take feminism as special treatment of women, then I can see this movie being problematic for feminists in the sense that a woman is not given a free pass regardless of what she does, though they address that in the movie as well, as they said in the conversation between the would-be sheriff and, I believe, the fake hangman, the yes. Oswaldo. They were saying, you know, do you have moral qualms? Or somebody else asked, do you have moral qualms about hanging a woman? And the response is, you know, if you once you invent a trigger that a woman can't pull, then you have to hang women. Meaning, if you have a death penalty for a crime of murder, women are just as capable of committing it as men. In fact, this is a very strong argument, I would say, for a more traditional, or I guess old-fashioned now, definition of feminism, that women are just as capable as men of being villains, of being evil, of being manipulative, deceitful, mean, not, you know, nice. And, you know, it wasn't really underscored, but in the very beginning, so let's see, the first chapter, or as I like to call it, you know, a man is stranded, you know, a man almost dies and is, you know, stranded, but, you know, women are affected. Because mm-hmm. the whole first chapter is that we see a black man who is at the mercy of another man who is in no mood to be taking passengers, and he either has faced starvation and death or hopefully be taken upon this other man's mercy. And yet the focus is on this poor woman who has a black eye and gets elbowed in the face. And she looks up all plaintively, like, but with strong female determination, saying, I got it. Now, what they don't really point out strongly, or maybe they do, and you just, you know, I'm assuming people can see this. Maybe they can't. I'll have to spell it out, I guess. You have a woman instigating a lot of disquiet and belittling and saying shit the man would get punched in the face for, or, you know what, maybe even shot. So she is waging emotional, mental warfare, which is the domain, the strength that women have in that regard. That's their defense. That's their mechanism of attack of other, because they're smaller. They're not as big as men. They can't fight them equally physically. So they have the mental and emotional defense or attack of that kind. And what men have to retaliate to it is physical strength. That's all men have. And a lot of times men don't particularly, I mean, it's changing now, but a lot of times men are very honorable and simple and not in a bad way, but I mean, they, you know, you guys know what I'm trying to say, where you have people that are like expecting others to be good and they themselves act in good ways and they assume no ill intent of others until proven otherwise. They just have kind of a, hey, let's be friends and cooperate and be, you know, in this together attitude. And they don't frequently see the subtle manipulations and the attacks and all that gossipy, catty stuff that a lot of times is the domain of women, because that's really, they don't physically attack each other. They emotionally attack each other. That's how they settle their fights and hierarchies, while guys just punch each other in the face and that's how they settle their hierarchies. They have different strengths and different domains of power. And so in that coach, we see that interaction. We see the interplay of the female strength of continually instigating. I mean, she was the first one to drop a racial slur with the two men were, or at least the character of the black bounty hunter, black marshal. He was very gently negotiating with this other man, and the other man gently negotiating with him back, because they were both armed. They both could potentially be upset at each other at any minute, and there was a tentative peace that was forming, and they had to use the sort of the right friendly words to make sure that they're on the same page. And then she busts in and starts, you know, trying to upset that balance and calling the other guy, you know, names. And she gets punched in the face because that's the only resort that a man has. He's nothing he can do on her playing field. He can't insult her back. That's not going to do anything. While she's damaging the bounty hunter's reputation, damaging the peace between them, she is actively waging warfare. She is trying to get her way, and in the only way she can as a woman. And we can see that very clearly, but for some reason, the only thing that's paid attention to is the fact that she gets punched in the face, while we're ignoring that that is the only recourse. She wasn't just talking about going to Baskin-Robbins, and he suddenly started punching her in the face. It's the same thing as, like, the Rihanna joke from Bill Burr. It wasn't that she was like, hey, guys, you know, let's all be friends, and then punch in the face. No, that's not what was happening. She was continuously trying to be do subterfuge and to basically escape while being a nefarious person to begin with. Theoretically, that's, you know, an assumption that's quite accurate that we're supposed to, you know, take. It's not like she's some misunderstood person. She really is a gang member and willing to kill anyone and everyone for it. It's really curious to me that they do not notice that males are reacting to something. They point and they say, toxic masculinity and male aggression. Well, it didn't come out of nowhere. She wasn't talking about petting puppies and suddenly he elbowed her in the face. That's not what happened. You have to see that there is a two-way street of communication and interaction, and that women are responsible for half of everything. And women get away with a lot of things that men get punched in the face for, but once you're a felon, you sort of forgo the rights of a lady, as they said. She is no lady. And that means basically she gets treated like a man. And guess what? They basically don't like these feminists. They don't like the way that men are constantly treating each other. That's what they're really talking about. And the fact that once in a lifetime it happens to a woman, once in like a million years, we have a woman finally in the role of a villain who gets hurt. Feminists are up in arms about it. But are they up in arms about the racist slurs against Mexicans and black people? Is that a thing? No, it's not. Where are your priorities?
Yeah. It further solidifies the stereotype that a lot of the people that would be complaining about these supposed misogynistic tropes in this movie have never been in these types of harsh, brutal environments, but rather are just confined to their rooms on Tumblr all day.
Yeah. And I would add that in the case of Lee's character, she was, from the beginning, sowing the seeds of dissent. Her method was super effective. And when feminists have a problem with men fighting against each other, or what they call toxic masculinity, I think that the main reason why they have a concern is that they're afraid that it will spill over onto women. Not necessarily that it happens to men, but that it could potentially spill over and affect women. And this film, for the people who have a problem with it, there was actually an interview with Kurt Russell, and he was basically like, this is in no way misogynistic. You know, and he thought it was pretty clear that the Daisy Domergue deserves... She was the most evil person in the movie. I mean, she was horrible, you know? So, but yeah, I mean, that's what I think it is. When they say that, they're concerned with the violence spilling over and affecting women. Not necessarily that it affects men, because they don't have a problem with asking feminist men to stand up to other men. They don't have a problem with using violence by proxy. They don't have a problem with using the state. They don't have a problem with using the military or the police or whatever. But they do have a problem when, you know, a man like goes on a killing spree or attempts to, like Elliot Rodger, says he's going to go kill women, kills more men, but the feminists are concerned because he killed some women. Like, that's the main core of the issue. So if there's anything that you could look at as sort of a case study as to what they really care about, you can look at that. But I think, Max, you wanted to say something else?
Yeah, when it comes to Tarantino, there's two things that I believe he's consistent in. It's one, that he always writes great characters, and two, he loves women. He loves female characters. That's been present to me ever since Pulp Fiction and Kill Bill. And in this particular case, I believe what's really, really interesting about the Daisy Domergue character, or however you pronounce her name, is that even though she might be the most evil, you know, it's arguable that she's the most evil person in the cast, she's probably the only person that I would be rooting for, because at least she's the most honest about her terribleness, whereas, like, you know, she hates everybody in that cabin. Like, she is, like, aside from, you know, her brother under the floorboards, right? Whereas everybody else, it's sort of just this giant charade that's inevitably going to lead them all to, you know, falling back on their primal instincts and shooting each other up, right? Like, they're all so polite to each other. It's like, oh, you're the hangman. Oh, you're a guy that, you know, goes out of his way to make sure that his bounty hangs, you know. It's, unlike the rest of them, I find that in a movie about villains where everybody is so despicable, I find that I'm the only one that's, I find that Daisy's the only one that I'm really rooting for to survive, because at least she has certain characteristics that make her a little bit more appealing, almost like a Walter White character from Breaking Bad, you know? So in that respect, I find it really, really difficult to understand why anybody would see this as a misogynistic film, just because, you know, Kurt Russell punches her in the face every time she speaks out of turn, when in fact that's probably just what the reality of the West was during that time, or you know, like a Western situation. And it also goes back to what we were talking about before the show, where it's just so silly that, you know, we could make a parody out of it where you just take like chapters, you know, in the movie where it's like chapter one, Road to Red Rock or whatever it is, and then just change it to, what was it? Like,
freezes nearly to death in the snow, hoping that someone would come along, women most affected. You mean like that?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yes, of course.
Man has to put down his own horse after it gets its leg broken in a pothole.
Women most affected. Yeah. yes, man forced to walk for 3 hours in the snow, butt naked, and is made to essentially be tortured, sucking on another man's dick unwillingly at gunpoint before finally succumbing to the cold and dying. Women most affected. That's the thing that blows my mind, is that, you know, there's a focus on, and this I'm going to get into where I think the reasoning why is. There is a focus on the violence that is visited upon Jennifer Jason Leigh's character, Daisy Domergue. We're meant, every time that she's hit, and I think that it's actually, I could understand that most people might cringe a bit on that, but what they may not understand is that the reason why they are is because it's a woman. And I think that the fact that a woman is being hit, despite the fact that she is wanted for murder, she is, you know, vile to the extreme, and she is willing to do whatever it takes, kill as many people as possible, or see them be killed. She watches the coffee get poisoned. She revels in everyone else's misfortune. She spits on the guy's, the Lincoln letter, you know, at her earliest opportunity. She is, she displays several times the degree to which she is a despicable human being and is likely very much deserving of whatever is coming for her. But when she is punched or elbowed in the nose or hit with the butt of a gun or whatever, I think that in the average person, it does make them cringe, because in part, because it's a woman, and we do have a knee-jerk, perhaps lizard brain response when we see violence visited upon a woman, especially a woman who appears to be shackled and helpless, because she couldn't do much. It's not like Kill Bill, where, you know, the bride was a capable warrior, and well, so when she got the shit kicked out of her, or when she got a shotgun full of rock salt in the chest and she was buried alive and all that, we were feeling for her and we wanted her to survive and everything, but we didn't feel like she was, you know, we felt like she was gonna be okay, or she was like tough enough that she could handle it. They established that right off the bat when she fights with the first woman.
Well, look,
So
I think Django may be, I haven't seen it, but I think it may be a better example of a helpless woman chained up from the trailers. I understand that's a lot of it was that. I don't really know what the point was, but I think this is a bad example of a helpless woman chained up because, or rather, it's a very thought-provoking on one hand. Well, I'll address that later, but real quick to the chain thing, she obviously is sowing dissent, as you said, the whole time. She is not helpless in that sense at all. And also the interesting thing is that one of the chapter names is Domingue's Got a Secret, and because she saw the poisoning and all that. And so she's kind of in an active role there, even though she's chained up. And ultimately, a bunch of people, like what, 8 guys, 9, almost died because of her.
Yep.
Actually, more people, close to 13 or 14, if you count Minnie and Sweet Dave and her family and all them. And so she is a... On top of that, I think he does a really good job of showing that she can take it because she gets elbowed in the face and she never cries. She never tries to say, hey, I'm a lady or any of that. And in fact, she continues with a face full of blood and busted out front teeth, you know, screeching and hollering like nothing happened. So she clearly is very, I don't want to use the term masculine, just very... tough, or in the way that we expect men to be, and the way we see men be all the time and don't give a fuck. And that's the second point that I have that I think is very intriguing and thought-provoking about this movie in particular, is that, yeah, you do have that weirded out, a squeamish response at seeing a woman hurt by a man, no less, a bigger, stronger man. And yeah, I'm sure the chain probably plays some subconscious part as well. And you see all of that and you're want to help her and you're just, you know, depressed about life and you know, everything is terrible and you just have this unease. But when you see a man get killed or vomit blood or in some way get just his like dick and his guts are hanging out, Caligula again, I still have PTSD about that scene, you're like, oh, that's gross, like, why you do that? Or, oh, hey, look, a guy's dead. So those are the two emotions that you get at most. So it's the really different, the very big difference between how much we tolerate hurt, pain, and murder of women versus the same thing or worse being done to men. And I think he really... Tarantino is aware of this. He probably has gotten responses, gendered responses, based on his other movies like Django and Kill Bill, because they have a strong gender relationship of one side sort of going after the other, if you want to put it in those terms. Or like all of the enemies are one gender versus one single protagonist of the opposite gender, as in Kill Bill. And I think he wanted to make this to... you know, play with people a little bit and to point out their own irrational and misandrist reactions.
Yeah, well, I want to clarify. I don't believe that the character is helpless, but I do think that I mean Daisy Domergue, but I do think that I could understand that a person like a normie, let's just say normies, would see a woman chained up for a crime. Getting, like, you know, punched in the face and stew, you know, like, spilled on her and elbows and, you know, all that. And they might have a moment of, ooh, I'm not comfortable with that. You know, I could see the average person doing that, but I don't feel that because I know that all I got to do is, you know, replace her with a man and see if all that would still be okay. And it is. I mean, like, I think it would work out the same. And I would have... no problem with it. So it logically follows that, you know, if she is the terrible person that, you know, John Ruth says, and we don't have any reason to believe otherwise, and she's behaving in a way, you know, like where she's not what they consider ladylike for the time period, at least. But I think that she's just, even by modern standards, like, I don't want to be friends with somebody like that. Like, I don't necessarily want to elbow her in the nose for no reason, but... you know, if she ends up...
But she's a gangster.
Yeah, she's a gangster, up a gangster, right. She is a gangster. So she's a criminal, murderer, whatever. And what follows is, you know, you're no longer essentially following the rules by our civilized, you know, world. So you're going to be treated like a criminal, which means you're not one of us, you know, essentially. Because you're not playing by our rules. So, and that's basically what the law is, you know, in like really simple terms. And... Also, you know, this is the thing where I think the contrast comes in. She got punched in the face. She got an elbow to the nose. She got, you know, a couple things happened to her. But when you look at what happened to everybody else, like the stuff that other characters have to go through, the, you know, getting the nuts blown off and, you know, getting stabbed to death and all this, the freezing in the cold while...
Well, I also would like to point out that there are two instances in particular that stood out that she actually received special treatment as a lady regardless of everything else that was happening.
Oh, yeah? Well, go ahead.
I would say three, technically. Two and a half, because one is disputable. You could say that he would do this for a man as well when he let her off the chain to eat. So that she could fuck around, and he let her fuck around for an extended period of time to the point of playing with the guitar. It's possible he would let a man do this. In my opinion, it's not that probable. So I would count that as three instances, along with the other two I'm about to mention. But you guys can feel free to discount it.
Yeah, I think that's possible. I think that there's also a chance that John Ruth would have considered a man more dangerous and may not have let him off. Instead may have forced him, because the reason why he let her off the chain was because her eating was fucking with
was
his
messing
ability
up with his hand. Yeah, but he let her stay. That's not the question.
Yeah, but he let her stay
specifically
off. Right.
Yes, that's the additional part, because he did cover it. He said, I'm not doing this for you. I ain't gone soft on you. But after that, there was a scuffle, or an emotional scuffle. They were talking about the dick sucking, the Mandingo and all that, and so he let her fuck around, and that's the questionable part. He might have let a man do that if he had seen that a man was, like, behaving and not trying to escape. Maybe not, because she was smaller and is just less of a threat physically in that sense. I don't know. Either way, the other two instances were specifically gendered and in her favor, and the first one was, I believe chronologically, the first one was when Oswaldo... instantly, which is very reminiscent of Elbow Gate to me, but he instantly, you know, feathered up, like puffed up his feathers as soon as he saw a woman walking in, and he's like, oh, excuse me, you have a woman on a chain? What is this?
Yeah.
Barbarianism. And it was his instant reaction. Of course, it couldn't possibly be that a woman has done harm. His first instinct is that, you know, he's a villain capturing an innocent woman, because that's the, you know, idea that we have been told about men. And so to see if that is the truth, he asked for the papers and the bounty. And of course, once again, proven false. That's not what was happening. And the second time was actually during the eating bit, I think, or maybe some other part where the hangman and Damagu are sitting together. And I think maybe during the eating part. And she has something like on her shoulder cuff, whatever thing, neck area, and he like leans in and almost paternally like wipes off something off of her, and I have a really hard time picturing him doing
it. Yeah, it was that's he does it to her mouth, and I remember like she had a piece of food like on the corner of her mouth or something, and he like gets it.
Was it her mouth?
Yeah, it's on her mouth, and he gets it out. And that stood out for me, too.
He's definitely not going to do that to another man.
Yeah, I thought that was really weird, too. Like, he was kind of like, you know, like, I think that it may... this is what I would suspect. And, you know, guys, chime in, like, you know, what your thoughts are, if you have any. I think that may come about when you think about the fact that he's probably been traveling with her for a long time. And despite the fact that his mission is to bring her to the hangman to be hanged, they have probably gotten to know each other or have become familiar in that time to some degree. And so
There's something to be said for, I think you're hitting a nail there, but of course somebody would say, well, what about the way he punched her? Well, you know what? This is frontier justice and frontier times, and she's a gangster, and a lot of times to people of that caliber, you have to show strength in order to be, it's like Game of Thrones quote, in order to be feared and respected. Do you want to be feared and respected? Or what was it? What is it the Red Woman said to Tyrion?
I don't watch Game of Thrones, I'm sorry.
Okay, to be obeyed and worshipped. There we go. Do you want to be obeyed and worshipped? That's basically part of rulership, is that, you know, even when the rulers are gone, your underlings or like the vice president needs to be obeyed and worshipped if you want to control huge masses of idiots or, you know, whatever. And so we're talking about someone who's a gangster, who's in the frontier world, who needs to be held with an iron glove, because that is a difference between life and death. If you allow her to get particularly mouthy, it could turn a situation against you, because in the end, a huge part of someone's survival had to do with convincing someone not to kill them. So if you talk and you talk the wrong words with some companion, and suddenly you end up without your bounty and you end up dead. So she needed to be shown the rules of things you're allowed and not allowed to do. So it was like super draconian stern fatherhood. And he was basically, in a way, caring and making sure, the only man committed to making sure she gets somewhere alive. He was the only guy doing that and caring for her. But whenever she crossed the line to the point where it would be dangerous for him as a bounty hunter with a criminal, he punched her in the face. So, I mean, it makes sense to
me. Yeah. Max, have you, you just watched it with us. What do you think the deal is with her, with John Ruth kind of like, while, you know, simultaneously treating her like a criminal and everything, but there's that moment where he wipes her face, which, you know, that Tarantino doesn't leave things in for no reason. Did that like come across at all? Did that stand out for you?
I wouldn't read too much into it, because like he wants to make sure that his captured victims stay alive, right? And in order to do that, there has to be some sort of element of nurturing, just to make sure that, you know, they don't pass out on him or, you know, starve. Or I honestly can't remember that particular scene from the movie. As far as John Ruth goes, I just, you know, I view all the particular characters in this movie as being just villains and not being very likable people, whereas she was at least the most real person, whereas everybody else was just sort of playing a facade, a kind of facade, just to try and put aside the truly terrible people that they are, whereas she was, from the start to the end, the exact same person. And as a result, it's sort of, you feel compelled to see her escape
even
from that, you know?
Minnie. Because even Minnie, and why is even Minnie, who in the scene they show her in, she is super duper sweet and friendly and accommodating. Like that scene, actually, the scene where that leads up to her death and all the other people in the haberdashery at that moment, feels, it's almost like out of place. Like it's like you're eating this, you know, really sour, like, I don't know, piece of food, and then there's like a sweet bit in the middle. And I think
it's relieving.
It is, yeah, because that's true. But the thing is, though, even Minnie isn't really the greatest person.
No, that's the thing. I think it makes absolutely everybody real. And I think I completely disagree with Max on everything he just said. I think everybody there is a complex character with depth, including Minnie, who you get to see sort of the human side of, you know, not necessarily everything that's pretty, but frontier people with, you know, strong passions about, you know, race a lot of times. And
I'm not saying that they're empty shells. They definitely do have depth of character. I'm just saying that on the whole, they're not very good people.
Well, no, nobody, I'm not arguing that in particular. I'm just saying that, okay. Yeah, no, I wasn't quite done yet there. But it's okay. On the other hand, Domagu is, to me, a very flat character as opposed to them. She has pretty much, you know, I mean, she's quiet most of it, so it's kind of not fair. She doesn't have that many lines to develop her character, but whenever she does, she's like, what is that movie? Deliverance People. She is like, to me, very, maybe it's the busted out teeth, I don't know, but her type of Western, I guess, Wyoming, that's not all that Western. It's almost Southern sort of banjo people kind of aggression and gangsterhood is super flat and reprehensible. Everything about her, I thought they made from beginning to end to be very loathsome and just not very likable. And I kind of agree with that, while every other character has degrees of redeemability. I mean, in the very end, you have the racist sheriff working with an equally racist black guy. They basically ended up working together against someone who was just reprehensible on an honorable level. And how did they do it? They hang her in honor of another man. Man, I mean, I'm getting choked up in here. So I feel like exactly the opposite.
Yeah, there was a bit of like, They wanted to honor a man that they didn't like very much, but just because he had a, so, like, and he had like a code that he lived by, like a he had a certain principle, you know, I'm talking about John Ruth, that he would not break if at all possible, and that is to get the bounty to the hangman. And like, they don't even really clarify why it's so important to him. Like, there is, they allude to, you know, where he says the hangman, you know, he needs to make a living, so I'm gonna make sure that he does. But he also takes a lot of pleasure in watching his bounties hang. So
maybe his daddy was a hangman.
Maybe. That's a good question. I don't know. But they honored that, and I think that that's pretty cool. There is an element of that.
And the guy you were certain was going to kill, the poor castrated black major, or marshal, whatever his name was, he completely kind of ended up working with him and staying also on the side of honor that they had, meaning they were on the right side of the law. And like you said, in the basic terms, law is, this is our set of do's and don'ts, and you either obey by them or you can't sit with us. So that's kind of, and we kill you or, you know, expunge you or whatever. So that was kind of the thing. She was on the other side of that, and she had absolutely no moral code or honor or anything, other than like familial ties with her brother or whatever. But on the other hand, they actually ended up overcoming their differences because they had something in common, which was she tried to kill them. She tried to poison him without warning him about anything at all. She didn't give a fuck. But John Ruth, who had no reason to like this guy and in fact disliked him because of the tension between him and Black Marshall, he ended up actually warning the guy with his dying breath. So there's this code and honor that the other guys end up upholding that she has absolutely none of, and I like them all and I hate her, so the end.
You know what I probably need to do? I need to watch this film again, and I need to do it with the perspective that I shouldn't watch this movie with the moral code that I have in real life. Rather, I should just watch it considering the fact that, you know, Tarantino establishes...
Take the Western code, frontier justice.
Yes, exactly. Just try to watch it with that perspective instead of just trying to relate all of it back to my own personal moral code. That way I might actually be able to see...
Well, there's another thing to it, too. Like, you're Canadian. I don't know if you guys had frontier justice the way that we do. Like, this is sort of, you know, it's not pretty... But, you know, at the time, I guess it was necessary, or at least... And, of course, Tarantino is, you know, he's dramatizing, he's exaggerating. There are too many weird coincidences with the way that these characters are actually connected that wouldn't really happen, even though our population around that time was much, much smaller, and the odds of probably running into somebody that knows somebody that you know are much higher than they are now. That was clearly, like, you know... highly, highly exaggerated for effect, and it worked out well. So yeah, there is that too. And there was something else that I wanted to bring up, because you were talking about the race thing, and that is a large part of what this film is about. But I think the way that Tarantino handles the complexity of it and the nuance is so... really, it's really actually very relieving and breathtaking for me, because I'm, you know, when you watch movies that deal with racism or media that deals with racism, most of the time it's directed in one direction. It's always, you know, white people being racist against a minority group. That's almost like 99% of the time that's how it's presented. And it creates a super agent and a completely agentless group of people. In all of these cases, and it's always done that way, and it's actually very, very predictable and very dull. And this movie, when I watched it the first time, I was shocked and blown away by how much things changed by the end. But the second time, which is the time I watched it just now, I was taking notes and I was really paying attention to certain elements, and there was actually a really, really great thing that I caught that I had to write down. I want to share this with you guys, and this is awesome. All right. Early on in the film, when Walter Goggins' character, Walton Goggins, who is another really great actor that I think deserves a bit of a nod, he played Sheriff Chris Mannix, or Chris Mannix, who may or may not have been the sheriff, we never really found out. That was part of the rebel gang that his father ran, and he was sort of presented as this hillbilly, redneck, racist guy from the South that, you know, was relatively straightforward. But as the movie goes on, he becomes a lot more interesting and complex. Like, he has a great deal of respect for his elders. He has, you know, he believes that he has some kind of code that he follows. And, you know, and he's also sort of like, from the beginning, he's put on the back foot as the character that you are supposed to disbelieve and distrust the most because of the people that he runs with and because of his beliefs about racism and stuff. But once... And so that actually puts him at a disadvantage in a way in the eyes of the people who are viewing the film. And he, early on when they're in the stagecoach and he's like talking to Major Marcus Warren's character, who's played by Samuel Jackson, he says, and this sort of almost gets him shot.
Because when niggas are scared, that's when white folks are safe.
And that actually makes Marcus Warren draw his gun on him. He gets really upset, right? And then they kind of calm down. And the movie goes on. And then later in the film, much later, okay, Marcus Warren says,
the only time black folks are safe is when white folks is disarmed.
So they actually present that these characters are, in many ways, they are mirror images of each other. And they both hate the other based on race. Or at least they have an incredible distrust or whatever, you know. And that is actually really interesting because they're the ones that end up bonding by the end of the film. They're the two survivors. Well, they probably don't live through the night, but they're the two guys at the end of the movie that are alive. Alive long enough to do good by a man, Kurt Russell's character, who is essentially, in many ways, he's on neither side because he gets choked up by reading the Lincoln letter. So he's actually, and he sticks up for Samuel L. Jackson's character.
Well, but then he gets
completely disillusioned. Yes, because when he finds out it's a lie, it makes him really angry. But the thing is, he doesn't necessarily like, he's not on either side of that. He doesn't like either of those people, you know. And it turns out that Samuel L. Jackson's character, while, you know, he tries to sort of justify it, he's actually full of a great deal of hate himself. And the way that he, you know, treats the son of the general in that story is evidence of that, because that's not justice, which is something that is talked about, mentioned earlier by Oswaldo Moresby, who is the fake hangman. He says,
the man who pulls the lever that breaks your neck will be a dispassionate man. And that dispassion is the very essence of justice. For justice delivered without dispassion is always in danger of not being justice.
Then that just slipped my mind, so shit. Never mind. Go on.
You know what? I was just going to comment on that. I never really considered it from that angle. Like I said, I was sort of considering the reality of this movie, just sort of reflecting it on my own reality. I guess I have to look at it from Tarantino's perspective. And the way that you presented that whole sort of bonding between Mannix and
Marcus Warren.
What's his name? Samuel Jackson's character. Marcus Warren. It's almost genius in a way, because it forces you to consider prejudice from an inconvenient and an unfamiliar manner.
And it also expresses that prejudice and racism can come from that direction, which is actually counter to the narrative that we often see. This is like a social justice warrior's nightmare. If they were to...
It's almost like racism isn't prejudice plus power.
Yeah.
Speaking of prejudice, the thing about that whole justice thing that you mentioned earlier, I have to use another quote. I'm not sure who said it. Might have been Oswaldo, might have been somebody else. You sure is an imaginative nigga. And that is, I don't know if that story is true with the whole killing his son and all that. He never gave... Because, you know, he lied about the other thing. So, I mean, part of me is like... How much of that is just bullshit?
It's possible that didn't happen.
Because he never gave any corroborating details of knowing his son other than his full name, which he may have overheard if they used the full name. If not, then I'm wrong. But
they may have mentioned his name, but that it's possible that he's still lying, because when it turns out that the Lincoln letter was a lie.
Right,
then you start thinking, well, you know, he could have lied about everything. But nonetheless, even
he mentioned, he's like, now you're seeing images. You know, that was, you know, an important part.
Yeah, but I mean, like, either way, his goal with the story was to instigate the general to act out of emotion and try to use his gun because he wanted to kill him.
Because he gives him a legal way of getting around. Because earlier he said that if you kill this man, two people separately, both the hangman and the would-be sheriff, said that they are going to hold him responsible for killing that old-timer if he does it just out of nowhere. So two separate people were going to hold him accountable for that, the sheriff and the bounty hunter. So he set up a situation that forced him to self-defend.
Pretty much.
Therefore getting away with all that.
And I would say that, you know, the old-timer, while I understand his reasoning for acting out that way, legally speaking, he was wrong. So that is, and that was, that worked out.
Because, if he was just entirely imagining it, then he would have shot a man for no reason.
Yeah.
Over a lie or, you know.
There is something else. Okay, so, yeah, we were talking about the violence and how it was visited on...
men?
On men. So, like, what are some of the...
All the dead men? All the fucking dead. There's, like, what, 3 dead women? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4 in the end. 4 dead women and, like, 14 dead men. So this is, yeah, absolutely right, like the Elliot Roger, where it's like more men of a racial minority, by the way, Asians, were killed in the Elliot Roger shooting, Santa Barbara shooting, than were women, and same with this movie. More men of, well, not of racial minority, but certainly talk of racial minority was happening, derogatory talk. So racial minority, check. More men killed than women, check. Do feminists talk about violence against women as an example of? Yes, check. So once again, this is the exact same situation with this movie as with the Santa Barbara shootings. Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous, I say.
Here's a weird thing. Like, this was the one thing in the movie that I thought it felt weird and out of place. There was a character in the flashback section named Six Horse Judy, played by Zoe Bell. I believe, I don't know if that's the same person. Is that the woman that Tarantino was sort of like started dating after he broke up with Uma Thurman? I don't know if you know, but like, so Tarantino's been like involved with a few different people, okay? So like for a while there, he was like totally in love with Uma Thurman. If you watch Kill Bill 1 and 2.
But wasn't she married with...
No, I don't think she was. I think that they may have gotten married. I don't really follow the whole, you know.
Yeah, I know Uma was like married to the Training Day guy and then they split. So that's all I know. That's where my cognition of those people
ends. Ethan Hawke. Yes, they were together.
That's all I know about her love life.
I think Max, you were going to chime in with something, but I just.
Oh no, I wasn't.
Oh, I saw your face on the screen. I was like, are you going to talk? But I think
I was just going to say it certainly wasn't Denzel Washington.
No, no.
You don't know.
If there's anything wrong with
racism.
That.
What's this racism?
No, no. But, no.
What is this? Subtle racism, microaggressions.
My nigga.
my nigga.
But, anyway.
What? I'm just quoting the movie. What?
I'm just quoting the movie. What? Jeez, how many times do we hear that word in this movie?
How
many times do we hear that in these hangouts? Yes. What?
Never, actually.
But, no, I'm not sure if it's the same person, but there was a... Zoe Bell might be the same person, but just to like real quick. So when Quentin Tarantino broke up with or got divorced by or separated from whatever Uma Thurman, which happened shortly after Kill Bill Volume 2 had ended. And if you watch the ending of Kill Bill Volume 2, it says something like Q and U. It's like brought to you by or special thanks to or something. And that represents that's representative of Quentin and Uma. So they were together. He put like a big fucking, you know, heart with the Q plus U in it at the end of the movie. He was head over heels for her, okay? And you can also see that because he has a lot of close-ups of her feet. But anyway, when they broke up, though, he started dating her stunt double. And her stunt double, I believe, is this person.
That is so
wrong. I know, it's weird, right?
That is so wrong.
Death Proof, okay? If you've seen Death Proof, the woman who is stuck to the, like, on the hood of the car for a good chunk of the chase scene at the second half where Kurt Russell's chasing them, and there's a woman on the car hood, that is the stunt double. And he started putting her in his films. Now,
how many conversations during sex do they have of, are you making love to me? Really? Me?
No. Yeah. Yeah. I'm making love to the stunt double of Uma Thurman because Uma Thurman Won't make love.
I make love to a stunt double of pussy. The woman I was married to, because that's not weird.
Bring in the stunt cunt.
Unless they had an arrangement. That's what I'm saying. Like, they might have had a stunt cunt as like an arrangement.
Yeah.
And then, you know, with the three of them, and then it went sour.
Maybe. I don't know. Who knows? Hollywood's weird. Maybe he...
Actors are weird. Fuck Hollywood. Yeah. Actors of all types, they're one step removed from porn, and sometimes they're not. And a lot of actors actually did porn to get into acting later on. So
maybe she was an actual stunt cunt.
Yes, maybe she was.
Well, Sybil, whatever, from Game of Thrones, which, Brian, you were omitted from this discussion for a second, dating Lannister, the horrible betraying cunt, that dated Lannister. She, Tyrion Lannister, the little imp that is, she was a porn star in Germany before doing acting in Game of Thrones. So she is like the German Sasha Gray, I guess.
Sweet.
Crossover star of the year. Anyway,
that's
you imagine Sasha Gray in Game of Thrones. That would be dope.
Quite.
Just joking.
Well, regarding, just once again, real quick, sorry about that,
okay.
But I have to talk about boobs. What is it, Monday? Damn, it's not Tuesday. Off topic. But Daenerys Targaryen actress, Emilia Clarke, she had a clause in her contract that she's not going to be naked in the movie or Game of Thrones series, and apparently she was the only one with such a contract. And this year, though, she did confirm that those were her real boobs 2 episodes ago, in the end of the burning fire house. So that's cool.
Real
and
boobs.
Go titties. Yeah.
Legit boobs.
Apparently, she's changed her mind on that whole thing. So that's cool.
Oh, sweet.
Because she was naked once before, and when she first burned down, with her baby dragons hatched. So that was like season 1. And I guess that was a body double. Though I may have heard there was a body double for Cersei's shame walk, but they may not have been. Who knows? Theoretically, there shouldn't have been. But now I could be wrong. I don't know. don't take my word for it, for sure. I do know, though, that Daenerys' boobs are, like, confirmedly hers in the other burning down now in season 6, I guess, so. Anyway, boobs. Yeah.
All right. Well,
I'm done.
All the real boobs. Well, anyway, what I was getting at was that Zobel, who may be that person, I'll look it up. Her character, though, Six Horse Judy, that was a weird character to me. I don't know what it is, but that was just, she felt so out of place. It was like this random New Zealand girl who was
running a horse.
And she was so incredibly saccharine sweet. And she was actually probably the besides like Sweet Dave, was probably the most innocent person in the film. And
well,
it was weird because she looked like she was 40. And I'm like, I'm not sure.
I'll tell you what. She was weird, and she was some stagecoach like helper from New Zealand. Super sweet. I think her purpose there was the same as the chicken plucking Jamaican lady that was Minnie's relative, I guess. As part of the murder scene, I think that was just to establish the absolute ruthless nature of this gang.
Yeah.
They gave a no fucks about who they were killing.
Yeah.
Personally, then the sweet, it's like, that's what I'm saying. It's like a Game of Thrones, it's like a Western Game of Thrones. All like the sweet, kind people, or at least more kind than others, because remember, Minnie hated Mexicans. But, or Sweet Dave apparently didn't hate anyone, but he was married to a Mexican hater, so there's that.
Yeah.
But either way, these more nice or somewhat nicer, just generally good people, given the circumstances of the Western world they were living in, were killed. And pretty much, well, everyone died in the end, which is also Game of Thrones. But the rule is all the sweet people die first, and then the evil people die, and then everybody dies. So that's exactly what this movie did in the same Game of Thrones format. But I find the person who was a stagecoach other helper to be an even less likely character, because it looked like he was wearing like a jacket, like a 1990s jacket and like a beanie.
The old guy?
No, the black guy who was just shot
yes,
back
Charlie.
In the outhouse.
Yes, Charlie.
Who the fuck was that? That was the most out of place character. I'm like, did you like quantum jump into here? What happened? Who are you? What are you? That was so weird.
Yeah.
To me, for some reason, was he one of Minnie's family? Maybe that's what it was, and I was just not getting it, because it seemed like he came with the carriage rider and. He probably didn't. So if he was Minnie's family, that makes a little more sense. But still, it's like, who is the, what is, no, what? So I guess I forgave the New Zealand girl her existence more because she was there to set up their, the evilness of the game.
Yeah, but she was doing this weird, like, Judy Garland, like, I'm sitting on the table swinging my legs and I'm skipping through the building. And I'm like, You're not 12. Mm. You're 30. The actress is 37 years old. And it's confirmed Zobel is Uma Thurman's stunt woman. She was also a stunt woman on Xena Warrior Princess. So that is the woman. So she must, she's probably still dating Tarantino. I don't know. Or they're still together or something, which is awkward. And
I guess she's not Xena's buddy stunt, but like Diana.
I don't know. Probably. I mean,
because Xena's a big old
yeah, woman. But she's I think
I love her. God bless her. Lucy Lawless is an amazing Australian beauty, but she's huge. Yeah. She's like 6 feet.
But you know, Uma Thurman's kind of tall too. She could have been Xena. Mm-hmm. Like they may have put a wig on her and had her do Xena stunts. I don't know.
That's true. It's possible. She'd have nice long legs that they made sure to show off when she fell dead on the ground. But she had these really nice, like, knee-length boots that laced up, and then those little riding pants that were tight. Am I objectifying a dead body right now? Oh, my God. Okay, let's move on.
Who's dead body?
Zoe, whatever. Yeah, when she died, she had these, like, long legs that were, like... They just made sure to zoom in on her legs when she fell down dead. It's not my fault.
It's not your fault.
That's when I noticed. Because they highlighted it. Not my fault.
Oh, that's right. Well, again, Tarantino has a thing for feet, man.
Well, wasn't feet she was wearing.
Yeah, she was, like, but he probably has a thing for
skin,
her feet.
Skin-tight legs.
That's true.
Leg.
Yeah,
things.
Skin-tight yeah. pants.
If he's into tall women, he likes feet because they are attached to really long legs. So I'm sure he likes both. Yeah. Anyway.
Okay.
Keep going.
Off
topic.
No, that's fine.
Number three. Take three.
Okay, so there was... so we talked about the mixed emotions. Of course, the one of the things we mentioned was Tim Ross character Oswaldo Morsby or whatever, Morbury. He is one of the first persons, like you said, to come out and say, "Oh my God, a lady!" I can't do the accent, but in this terrible blizzard, you know, and he's sort of like.
He has a particularly English accent yeah. of a particular type. I can't quite place it because there's different accents between London and Manchester yeah. than like Northern England.
Yeah. Well, he was playing up the whole like the super posh like pip pip cheerio type, but in reality,
I don't know, he creeped me out the whole time. I was just like, this guy is so sleazy, creepy. Yeah. What the fuck?
Yeah, but then
he was just really not sitting well.
No, but when he lets his guard down, he becomes like, you know, just more. Like Cockney. So, all right. So let's go to the last bit because Max, you're on borrowed time. How much time do you have left, man?
Only like a couple minutes.
Well, we can briefly look at the articles, and if you need to take off, that's okay. I'll just look at the headlines. So, on this was one from Killscreen.com on Quentin Tarantino's masterpiece of misogyny, The Hateful Eight. And I'll just. Read this briefly. The gauntlet is thrown down early. Kurt Russell's Ursine bounty hunter John Ruth smashes his captive Jennifer Jason Leigh's Daisy Domergue full in the face when she speaks out of turn. She gets a lingering close-up courtesy of Tarantino's vaunted glorious 70mm frame seething with fury through the blood.
No, not speaks out of turn. It wasn't about... proper polite conversation or you don't speak until spoken to language or mentality. I mean, it was about her using, first of all, offensive racial language.
Yeah.
Pretty sure that's the first outburst. She called Black Marshall a nigga. Yeah. Actually, even less polite than that. And then was saying, are you just going to let him, you know, hump you like that, basically. So that's not speaking out of turn. That's actively attacking somebody and questioning their decisions and using a racial slur against their new friend and disturbing the peace and overall being a jackass and a mean bastard. So there.
The second paragraph, let me read the rest of this bit. I lost count of how many times Domergue gets slapped, thumped, and punched, but I'm comfortable with saying it was a lot.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did they lose count of how many men died? Or was that too many that they lost count?
It is aggressively distasteful provocation, calibrated to leave no viewer on the fence. The film is deliriously violent, but these moments of intimate, inescapably loaded abuse cut just a little bit deeper than the piles of exploding heads and bloody vomit. That's funny. Like, this guy, this person, let me see who wrote this. The person who wrote this,
oh, there's
Zach
just exploding
Bugor.
Heads and bloody vomit, yeah. Which means that you know, men are having their heads exploded and they're experiencing bloody vomit all over the place. But, you know, they're just some random disembodied stunt heads and stunt vomit. But a woman is being hurt. First of all, it's a movie. People, it's a movie. But okay, let's just say we are saying this is real life. We are presenting this movie as a window into life. And this is really how people would act if this was the Western frontier right now in Wyoming. This is what they would do. Okay, she's a prisoner. First of all, you're discounting that 100%. And secondly, I just don't understand how you can have such pure objectification of male suffering and death as, say, you know, heads exploding and bloody vomit all over the place. But it's just yucky, gross goo. But there was a woman who got slapped and thumped. Oh, my goodness. My morals, my panties, my bonnet. I can't.
The guys who were, like, dying from the poison, their insides were probably getting melted or something. Like, it was a lot of blood. And it was
excruciating pain and death.
Exactly.
I mean, she died too in the
she
end.
She did. She was
still. That's not the point.
She was hung
for the longest time. And how about the fact that she killed the only man invested in keeping her alive? So first of all, yeah, okay, her brother wanted to keep her alive, and the gang members. I don't think that necessarily counts because it wasn't a gendered. Well, his wasn't a gendered thing either. So either way, she murdered actively her ally. Mm-hmm. In a sense, ally of the moment, because obviously he was taking her to be hung as part of the law. So either you want the law to function or you don't get another option. So unless there's a trigger that women can't pull, you have to exercise the law equally, as, you know, your feminism definition says you roll like that, all about equality. Yeah. So she is a prisoner that has to be executed eventually. But for the meantime, all these people are after her, and the only man who could keep her alive, she killed. And that's somehow we are supposed to identify with her plight.
Yeah.
A caring man internal bleeding turning into blood vomiting, and then shot by the person he was, you know, somewhat protecting. But women affected.
Yeah, women most affected, of course. No matter how terrible a person they are. You know, actually, real quick, as an aside note, I'm just throwing it in there. I just realized that considering it's about a bunch of people trapped in one small space for an extended amount of time because there's a blizzard going on, and it's a game of find the villain, like, who's the person that you're...
Yeah, it's Clue,
but it's also, like, The Thing, which is the movie from the early 80s. About an alien that can disguise itself as a human and is hiding amongst the men that's an all-male cast, though. But they're in this, like, sort of northern or Arctic scene. And Kurt Russell was the main character.
The alien could have been a woman. You don't
what?
Know. The alien could have been a woman.
Yeah, but there were no women there. Like, in The Thing, the cast is all men, so...
Well, no, the alien.
Oh, we don't. Yeah, we don't know. Female we don't gender. Know what it was.
Yeah, see, your microaggressions and your assumed sexism, Brian. You're such a shit.
Well, they could have also been asexual. We can't go around gendering things. So yes, you're right.
You're right. I'm so sorry. I did not ask his preferred pronouns.
Okay, let's see. Let's go to the next real quick.
Next pile of shit. I mean article.
Yeah. Hipster misogyny. The betrayal of the Hateful Eight. Okay, yeah, hipster misogyny, yes. I don't.
What part of that is hipster? Do you know? I do not think this word means what you think it means. You think you're misusing this word hipster just a tad. It's a Western. Yeah. Repeat after me, West.
All right, let me read the little bit here. Okay, I'm in the ladies' room during the 12-minute intermission of The Hateful Eight. I guess there was an intermission in the theater. Not when I watched it, though. The line of men outside waiting for the bathroom is loud and chattering. But the mood where I'm standing, this is a woman that wrote this article, is quieter and more subdued. This may have...
Where is she standing? Was that? Where is she standing?
She's in the bathroom. The women's bathroom, I guess.
Oh, the women's bathroom.
This may have something to do with what we've watched for a past hour and a half. The titular octet includes but one woman, the outlaw prisoner Daisy Darmagoo, played by Jennifer Jason Leigh, who serves as a literal punching bag for her captor, the bounty hunter, John the Hangman Ruth. She starts the film with a deep black saucer of bruising around her eye, and shortly after her introduction, Ruth cracks her on the nose. We hear the snap of her cartilage with the surrealistic clarity of a Looney Tunes classic. This isn't even the last time she is hit before the group reaches Minnie's haberdashery, where the film's plot, which feels like Agatha Christie does John Carpenter's The Thing, well, look, she mentions it herself, grinds into action. I ask...
The first time isn't even the last time she's hit.
I know, oh my god, she's hit more than once in this movie. I ask the woman washing her hands next to me how she's liking the movie. Her curt reply is, I could deal without him hitting her. We get the point already.
Do you though? Do you? Because I don't think you do. I don't think you get the point. I think he's going to have to keep hitting her until you get the fucking point. That men around you are having their heads exploded, literally, to the point of not being good enough for bounty even because they're unrecognizable. All value stripped, even post-death value. I know.
Well, let's keep going. She says, but this is Tarantino, I tell myself. His films are pageants of lovingly articulated carnage. Male and female bodies alike are assaulted with bullets and fists. They are scalped and raped and ribboned with swords. But the violence is always in service to something. It is the catalyst for a roaring rampage of revenge, or an instrument of that revenge. At its most frivolous, it gives us a grand fuck yeah moment. And at its most profound, it illustrates with a broad brush the horrors of oppression, whether that oppression comes from Nazis or slavers or creepy assholes who think they're entitled to a pretty girl's attention. What?
Quick point. Is that Django?
Well, the slaving thing is a Django and Chain reference, yes.
No.
I don't know what that's a reference to. I got to think about that one. That.
You probably know his movies better than I, but I would like to point out the thing you just read. Could you read the first sentence again? There's a lot there.
But this is Tarantino. I tell myself his films are pageants of lovingly articulated carnage. Male and female bodies alike are assaulted with bullets and fists. They are scalped and raped and ribboned with swords. But the violence is always in service to something. It is the catalyst for a roaring rampage of revenge, or an instrument of that revenge. At its most frivolous, it gives us a grand fuck yeah. And at its most profound, it illustrates with a broad brush the horrors of oppression, whether that comes from Nazis or slavers or creepy assholes who thinks they are entitled to a pretty girl's attention.
So in the end, when they did have their aha or fuck yeah whatever moment, when in the end they finally hung her up, which, I mean, at that point, you didn't know for sure if she's telling the truth. But regardless, she was a force of destruction that was leveled upon them. And because of her, they suffered egregious harm, castration, for one. Possibly both were going to die. So, I mean, especially if you're going to die, one of the last things you're going to do is to make sure that the person who caused you all that harm is also dead. I mean, there's a point of, I don't want to say vengeance, but there is sort of tit for tat. It is a justice in its own way of that type, a bit of frontier justice, but there's that. And if they were to live out the day, or rather the sheriff was, he is going to have the dead bounty of this woman. So there's still that dead or alive element that, you know, you can account for. So they had the fuck yeah moment by hanging her, finally doing the thing in honor of a man. It was a very moving sort of moment. So it had both. Also, on top of that, it had violence for a point. It did have a point, I think, and that's what they're missing. They're missing the point that you have a natural squeamishness towards women being physically hurt, and yet you will accept egregious levels of violence towards men. Scalping, decapitation, having your head completely exploded, having your insides turn out through bloody vomit. Everything and anything imaginable. That's far more gruesome than getting punched in the face and thumped over and over for 2 hours, which is what their main complaint was. It wasn't about the fact that they killed her in the end. They seemed to be okay with that. It was the fact that they punched and thumped and slapped her for 2 hours. And so any level of egregious violence towards men is acceptable and, in fact, expected and welcome as a Tarantino vehicle, in a Tarantino vehicle. But this happening to a woman for 2 hours, getting slapped? Oh no, well, we can't handle that. That was just too much. You're crossing the line there, man. What is this? What kind of violent monster are you? So yeah. I think there is a point to the violence that you're not fucking getting, idiots.
And I'm very... No, and well, here's another thing,
grumble.
The person who wrote this, and this is actually not some, you know, tiny blog somewhere. This is RogerEbert.com, although Roger Ebert himself has been long gone, but it's written by someone named Laura Bogart. She this is the thing about Laura Bogart, okay? This is what I'm gleaning from this article. She basically believes that violence needs to be profound at best, which means it needs to address the horrors of some kind of oppression or revenge against oppression. And that's, so she's looking at this through an intersectional lens. She's seeing it as, you know, if you're going to visit violence upon someone, it has to be based on identity politics, oppression. So if, you know, Django kills a bunch of white guys, that's fine, even if those white guys did not do anything involving slavery or were not racist themselves, but were just kind of around, for whatever reason, that's totally cool. Because it's the black man killing the white man. If it's a woman killing men, that's totally fine. If it's, you know, like, it depends on the direction in which it swings. This is where she comes from. So when you have a situation where a character like Daisy Domergue, who is a criminal and a murderer and deserving of all of the punishment that is levied upon her, if not more, and it's all justified based on her actions and not her identity, this woman takes issue with it because she doesn't see her as an agent. She doesn't see her actions. She doesn't see how dangerous that woman is based on the fact that there were men that were willing to visit violence on anybody that stood in their way in order to rescue her, despite how innocent they might be. And I'm not trying to give those men a pass. They're obviously criminals and they deserve what comes to them as well. But we're not, the thing is that this woman is basing what is right or wrong depending on the identity of the people involved and not necessarily the actions that those people take, which is why she can't see Daisy as a villain, or she doesn't think that Daisy should be because she's a woman and women should not be villains.
I think, you know, just to, you know, play devil's advocate, or to give them a little more credit, perhaps than that, you know, to hopefully see them live up to it, is that maybe what the issue here is a lack of understanding from a woman, especially. But, you know, men are quite complicit in this too. And in fact, it happens more often to men, and that's why they're bigger victims of it. Where I don't think she is realizing the female attack mode and all the variety of ways in which Daisy did attack, but in a very subtle, cutting, emotional, mental attack, mental warfare sort of way, mm-hmm. that women are quite used to, and they're used to not being called out, and so they're used to supporting each other in it. That's a lot of the toxic feminism that we see, and toxic femininity is women supporting each other in being, you know, toxic. And because of that, I think maybe she's not aware of all the ways in which she was doing things that, first of all, if a man would do it, it would cause him to be hit in the face or dead. Because think about it, not earlier she was, you know, talking about nigga this and that, but obviously that doesn't necessarily make someone kill someone. Though I bet Black Marshall would have killed the redneck would-be sheriff guy if that guy wasn't a possible would-be sheriff. I mean, who knows? He might have after a while of him, you know, calling him names. So having a woman do this instantly, the first words out of her mouth after which she got punched was a racial slur towards another man. And somehow we're supposed to forgive that. Okay, moving on. Yeah. Then later she was singing that song about how she's going to, you know, leave John dead and go to Mexico. And it's like, you're basically flaunting in front of my face that, you know, you're going to fuck me over and kill me. And you're a prisoner on top of that. So much of that would not be allowed from a male prisoner. So not only are they doing the typical feminist thing of never, ever, ever, ever turning the lens or the mirror on themselves and never checking for hypocrisy, which is to me one of the essential tools of intelligence, is you check your own behavior and your own thoughts and your own approaches to things for something that you're calling someone else out for. You make sure that you either don't do it, or if you do, you change, or, you know, change your opinion on that subject, or change your behavior to adhere with not being a fucking hypocrite. And feminists never seem to do that. And on top of that, I think they're just really used to women cutting men deeply to their core in front of them and in front of everyone else, and that being completely acceptable. And I have seen plenty of evidence like that, usually in married couples, but not always. Sometimes you have a really dominant, aggressive, well, not sometimes, often, sometimes it's subtle, but you have an aggressive, cutting, mean-spirited person who is doing things that, first of all, men would never do, but if they would get punched in the face and or shot in this frontier world. So the fact that they're not seeing this, I think, shows that, I know that women are used to it, and I know they support each other in it. So I think the problem is them not realizing that this is a problem, and once again perpetuating the cycle of allowing women shitty behavior without any accountability. Absolutely zero accountability for anything. The issue isn't that she was a criminal and being taken to be hung. The issue is that she got physically hurt in response to what? As I was saying, it's not like she was saying, hey, let's pet puppies or let's go to Baskin Robbins, and he just punched her in the face. That's not what was happening. She was instigating, and the only recourse that men have against female emotional and mental warfare is physical warfare. That's how the dice fucking rolls. That's how it is. And they're just not realizing that women are attacking all the time, attacking men, and are allowed to attack men. And it's a norm. And they are now upset at the fact that it is being punished as it should be and as it is with men. And they just don't like equality, once again. They don't like actual true parity.
Well, I'm going to go into more of her review because I want to show you where she's coming from. She is definitely a feminist, and she believes that films that are not feminist films are not good films, basically. So here's where I'll go into it a little bit so you can see where this woman's head is at. First, she says, if anything, Tarantino has been, in his own way, a subversively feminist filmmaker. He is the man who gave us Beatrix Kiddo punching her way out of a coffin and 6 feet of hard earth. Shoshana Dreyfus ending the Third Reich with a cackle and a match. And Abernathy Ross axe-kicking a serial killer of women right in the head. Yet I find that when the lights come up on The Hateful Eight, I don't come away with any sense of purpose or a point. I spend 3 hours watching a kind of gleeful viciousness deployed not only against Daisy, but against the few other women who appear on screen. And all I have is a bitter, coppery taste in my mouth. Daisy exits to be punched and to rebound from those punches like Daffy Duck after he has had his bill blown off. She smiles and scowls with a mouthful of blood, inviting the audience to laugh at her pain. That doesn't
just real quick. I don't think she was doused with blood to her face, which I mean happened to her, not by her design, but she didn't wipe it off. She gave no fucks. I don't think it was that as much as her not giving any fucks and being a terrifying gangster that she was, as she was screeching that none of you are going to leave this mountain alive. I got men coming to kill you. I guess she missed that part. Or what maybe it was is if she's a Tarantino fan, from what I understand, women who have had some struggle in their lives of some type, like, you know, even doing exams or having some sort of dark period, given, you know, your own life, meaning like some people's dark period may be a lot deeper than other people's because they just, you know, life circumstances. But whatever women struggle with, you know, like midday exams or, you know, some sort of loss in a family. But sometimes to them, the movie Kill Bill has been helpful as a way of a woman, as you said, shot to the chest and buried and then rising up and overcoming all these difficulties. And they kind of use that movie as a way to express their feelings and their frustration and the obstacles they had to overcome. And so they really like it. So that movie to me is particularly exemplifying of one of the biggest issues with the feminist frequency critique of video games, that it is violence towards women because 99.9% of men, or sorry, I already gave away the joke, 99% of people you kill in video games are men.
Mm-hmm.
So
women most affected.
Yes. Women most affected. And to me, Kill Bill is the perfect example of that. And I use the photo of the bride in the middle surrounded by 40 Asian guys. It was like they're
crazy literally
identical looking too. So they are literally objectifying the male villains while giving all agency and story and background and everything that's against objectification or the opposite of to the female lead. So that to me, and of course throughout it has a variety of female leads and nameless faceless males that get slaughtered. So that's just kind of a taste of that movie that I think people may or women may unintentionally sort of take on. And especially if they already believe in the idea of the patriarchy or that there are men out there, there's a glass ceiling or there's a boys club or any one of those keywords that basically sets the genders apart and women sets up women to war against men. So that whole thing, I think, somehow gets subconsciously activated. And so it seems to me this woman was watching this movie and entirely somehow putting herself in the position of the female gangster. I mean, that's why she was tasting copper, the blood in her mouth, like the lead character. It's like, so the only thing you notice, because you are seeing things not how they are and then classifying them into the gendered baskets. What you're doing is you're putting on your gender glasses and only seeing one basket. You're like, oh, look at all the women that died. There's four of them in the whole movie. And the men that died is over 10. So that's like three times, you know, at least three times. I'm sure there's been 12, up to 14 men died. So at least three times as many died as women.
And a couple of horses.
There you go. And there's been racial, you know, warfare left and right. And yet none of that gets mentioned. And the only thing that you say is somehow you turn Daisy and two other black women who didn't even know each other. And in fact, it was Daisy's people that killed those black women.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow you group the women together into this vagina club and you identify as all of them and you come out of a 2 hour and 47 minute movie feeling that the whole thing was men beating up and killing a variety of three women.
Yeah.
And you somehow don't see it for what it is and then classify it into its underlying themes. You come in there obviously with not just a something to look for or a lens maybe that you're trying to analyze from, but specifically blinders, specifically selective vision, selective memory. Not just vision, but selective memory. Well, I guess vision and memory are related. What you see is what you remember. And they do this weird thing to their memory of reality, and no wonder there's no logic and postmodernist insanity all over the place. They have lost the ability to sense reality because they never remember reality.
No, they remember their reality, and it is a postmodern thing. And I'll take it a little bit further to show you where this woman's head is at. She, in the next paragraph, she writes, "The film ends on the image of a lynched woman." So we're supposed to think now, you know, Daisy Domergue, we're supposed to sympathize with her in this instance, according to the way this woman's writing it. Her face, a monster's face, blood caked and swollen before the noose ever cinches around her neck. Daisy is strung up by Chris Mannix, played by Walton Goggins, the Marauder, that was what they called him, or the good old boy, and Major Warren, played by Samuel L. Jackson, who is, if not the movie's moral center, then the smartest, most compelling character, and therefore the de facto focus of the audience's attention, which gives her murder a sense of legitimacy. So she believes, yes, that's what I was getting at. She believes that Samuel L. Jackson is the moral center of the film, despite the fact that he is just as racist and just as hate-filled as the Southern, you know, good old boy guy was.
No, if anyone, the hangman is the only moral center in that whole, the hangman and his driver, that was the pure center. I mean, as pure as a bounty hunter can be, obviously.
Yeah.
But as far as bounty hunters go, I mean, shit, that guy was like,
he was a professional,
pristine person in terms of frontier justice, type of area survival law rule thing. And he was not racist. He was, like, in fact, super anti-racist. He was shown to be an emotionally moved person. And, in fact, when challenged in a toxic masculinity way by a black marshal or major, which one is it?
Major. He's it. Major.
Black major. Yeah. So they kept calling him Black Major. That's the only name I remember him by. So he even says, oh, did I hurt your feelings? And he thinks about it for a moment and replies with, you know what? Yes, you have.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a compelling moment because guess what? You know, you kind of, to me anyway, I sat there and pondered about the fact that, you know, not only is this man okay with expressing that sort of thing, which why would we think that men are not? Because, you know, fully developed men are completely capable of expressing their feelings in the right circumstances. And he was like, yeah, it did hurt my feelings. And then you sat there and think that's like, you know, somehow the fact that you hurt this man's personal feelings, that he believed you, he trusted you, and you violated that, that gave so much depth of character and just another level to look, like another angle to look at things. And I don't know, I found it really cool. And to me, the guy that Kurt Russell played was the emotional center, or the rational, not rational, but, you know, like the innocent emotional a moral compass, sort of the emotional goodness center there. And sure, the Black Major had some redeeming qualities, just as the good old boy had some redeeming qualities.
Yeah.
But, you know,
well, they weren't presented in a flat way. It was like, okay, this guy, we're going to give the initial impression that you should have about this person, or we're going to play with what you're expecting. And then as it goes on, you're going to learn, you know, maybe it's going to undermine your expression. In fact, specifically with the Black Marshal and the good old boy, the sheriff, those guys do, there's a lot of reversal that happens, because I think the average viewer, if they introduce a character that is a Confederate rebel soldier, racist, good old boy, hillbilly white guy, people are going to be in their head. They're going to say, okay, I am supposed to hate this man because he's racist, he's white, he's Southern. He ticks all the boxes of what you're supposed to dislike. And then the black man, you're supposed to feel... Yeah.
No, but you do the beautiful Tarantino thing that he did with same as he had men who were, in essence, good or better than the women. And then he basically flipped the script. He's doing that for this whole racism conversation thing, because you have that in The Good Old Boy, but you also have someone who I joined the war to kill white Southern crackers. Mm-hmm. So it's, I mean, so sure, okay, he's not against Northern crackers, but, you know... Still, it's a form of racism. It's a form of prejudice that you're willing... It's a form of bigotry. Basically, that the bottom line is we are all a bit racist. We are a bit sexist. We are a bit stereotyped. Not stereotyped, but we prejudiced. Sort of... not specifically prejudiced, but we do sort of act on stereotypes. And the reason stereotypes specifically exist is because a lot of times groups of people behave in particular ways that earn them the stereotypes. The only way to get rid of a stereotype is for that group of people to start behaving in a different way. And then the stereotype will change. That's the nature of what it means to have to be a stereotype or to have one. So we all believe in those to one, you know, level or another. We all have certain... racist, sexist, and I'm using that extremely broadly and extremely loosely, but all of us have different preconceptions and experiences on which we base our expectations of the world. But what the difference is between a bigot and a not bigot is a person who takes individuals on a case-by-case basis. Mm-hmm. That is the big difference. And a bigot never does that. They assume that every person of a particular group they meet will be irredeemable, nothing different about them, nothing to gain, nothing to see there, kill them all. That's a fucking bigot. So he is still a bigot. Just because it's Southerners that are their white crackers that he doesn't like and not all white crackers doesn't make it any less racist or bigoted. So very much you have what is called reverse racism, which is, of course, is almost an oxymoron. It's just racism. But we've gotten to the point of not acknowledging racism towards white people to the point of them being denied the word racism or that behavior to be against them, to be called racism. It has to be called reverse racism for people to even know you're talking about.
In the West, in the United States, at least, I don't know about other countries in the West, the one group of people that it's totally okay to be racist against is white people. The one group of people that is totally okay and acceptable to be sexist against is men.
And to harken back to the movie, that's, you know, as the general old timer was denying Black Major his he was denying his personhood. He didn't want to talk to him directly. He didn't want to acknowledge that he existed, basically. Until the very end, he was like, will you acknowledge at least that I shared a battlefield with you, or will you deny me even that? So basically, they made peace even there. Even that was like a redeemable character development moment for both of those characters, a little bit. The old man, he's a son of a bitch, so he can die, I don't care. Because he just was totally working with, he doesn't give a fuck about anybody, as we see in the end.
Yeah.
He was completely working with the gangsters. And pretty much all gangsters and old-timer, all of them, for the most part, are irredeemable, well, except
the old timer was pretty similar to Jennifer Jason Leigh in a way, in the way this one way. The old timer wanted to survive. He was willing to do whatever it took to survive, so he played to his strengths by being an old man that, you know, would be useful to the gang. And his hope
was his own kind of gangster.
What?
He was his own kind of gangster.
Yeah, he was in his own way. But basically, he was like, I need to get out of this situation alive. I'm going to do whatever they tell me to. Daisy Domergue was also only interested in surviving. She was willing to do whatever it took. allow as many people to die as possible. She was willing to let everybody get poisoned. She was willing to, even her own, like, fellow gang members, she was willing to let them all die. Just the only person she really cared about besides herself was her brother. And she was even willing to shit out, as they put it, 15 extra guys and endanger, or threaten to endanger, an entire town of people so that she can get out. That her willingness to survive the situation was far and beyond the one thing that made her, you know, the most, like, one of the most vile characters, but it also is the way in which she was similar to the general, because he was also looking to just get out of the situation alive.
And he killed a lot of people during the war.
Yes, he did. Sure. Well, they actually talk about it a little bit. So we know that there are really not any good people in this film, but there are some that are less bad than others. And I think I'm with you, aside from the people that were completely innocent, like Charlie, that was like the black guy that was, you were saying, why are you even here? And like some of the people who were
New Zealand chick.
Yeah, the woman that was plucking the chicken.
Yeah, the Jamaican lady with the jelly bean.
And the random New Zealand woman that showed up that was...
Sweet Dave seemed sweet.
Yeah, and Sweet Dave,
Minnie was just, you know, a little racist against Mexicans, but otherwise seemed like a nice lady.
Well, you know, it's weird. Like, when they went in there, I thought this was odd. She said absolutely no Mexicans, and then when they went in there was a Mexican there, and she didn't say you can't be here. She didn't tell him
Did he ever take off his hat, though?
Yes, he had to take off his hat, and he introduced himself. All he said was Bob. And
yeah, he didn't say Mexican.
He didn't talk to her, but he did go to watch the guys play chess, and I guess she didn't overhear it, or she just decided to deal with it. But that was
you're right, because he did sound, I mean, he had a pretty heavy Hispanic accent.
Very.
Well, I guess Mexican accent, because it was called, like, what, Marco the Mexican or whatever his name was. So, that's a really good point, now that you bring it up. She did take the sign down.
She did, because she was allowing dogs.
Right. But I think I know, I thought that was funny. I'm a terrible human. I thought, first, I'll get back to my point, but was it just me, or did everyone think that, in a way, this was the subtlest of Monty Python-type comedies?
Oh, I don't know. I didn't really think.
Because, no, the whole thing is, like, entirely a setup for a joke. It's, like, eight guys, and it's, like, two bounty hunters, a sheriff, a cowboy, and an outlaw end up in a cabin in a blizzard. Tell me that's not a setup for a joke.
It is.
Come on.
It is.
It's the whole thing is just, I think, and there were some funny moments in the way they dialogued, the way it was written with almost alliteration, but it was like, I don't know, I'll probably butcher it. I can't remember any of the specific examples, but it would be something like, I need to know everyone here and I don't know you, so I need to know, you know, who are you? Mm-hmm. Like something like that. It was like funny-ish stacks of words and replies. It could be said, obviously, that they were characters, but they were particularly colorful extremes almost of characters. Yeah. And there was at one point a line that sounded a lot like Monty Python. And I was like, wait a minute, I think this is one of those internal chuckle, amusing sort of comedy setups along with everything else until it got super gory towards the end. But from what I understand, I think that might be a Tarantino thing, because isn't Pulp Fiction like comedic in a certain
way? Oh, yeah. Pulp Fiction has humor in it. Kill Bill has humor in it.
Right. I think it's the same thing.
There's a little bit of humor in a lot of his movies.
Yeah, I definitely saw it in here, but it was very subtle and almost on a drier British Monty Python side, mm-hmm. where it was like so ridiculous. This whole situation was so ridiculous. Because, like, you know what was funny? It was like, kick it open, kick the door open. It's like, nail it shut.
Oh, yeah, the door.
Use the two boards. Like, it was fucking hilarious.
God damn it.
And it was quite well done. All around.
Yeah. No, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. So, I guess, I mean, there, you know, we can go into more. There's definitely more to look at. For those of you guys who are watching, leave us a comment. Talk about the gender, the way they handled, you know, the Jennifer Jason Leigh character and the way the other characters interacted with it. Also, the race thing. I think that they do some interesting things where they play with this idea. And I don't know if Quentin Tarantino was aware of it or not. But they play with this idea of power plus privilege. Because there are situations where that is reversed. Like, if you are a woman and you have an entire gang of armed men, do you not have the privilege and the power at that moment? When you're a black man and you have your gun pointed on a naked white man in the snow, Do you not have power and privilege in that moment? Like, what? How are we defining that? Does Tarantino, is he aware of it, or is he just sort of, is he just, you know, stumbling upon that?
I think he's 100 million thousand percent aware of it. I think this entire movie is very much a, unless he somehow lifted the archetypes from, it's a remake or something, if he somehow took the same types of, as I say, archetypes, not yeah. specific characters, but just, you know, archetypes. And because he is showing dualities of everything that is particularly pertinent to the conversation, the social conversation currently, where we have race and gender very in very strong ways amplified and simplified down to just, you know, a few pegs that you can easily follow. So it's like very simple, almost pantomimes, like puppet theater of gender roles and race roles and power roles. And yes, a gun is a big part of it in frontier justice, because that's, you know, a lot of times, especially if society were to crumble, or in burgeoning societies, or in a lot of second, third world societies, basically at a human level, that's where humans are at a lot of times, unless they're like hyper enlightened elven like. They, for the most part, are the variety of those people we saw in that hut at its most basic, primitive frontier justice, Western frontier people, humans. That's what they do. That's how they act. They either have crude laws put together or they have none, and people with guns come over and kill innocent people, and then you got to protect. It's just, it's all the basic shit that you got to deal with. Mm-hmm. So on that canvas, where it's simplified to the basic level of humanity, you have very black and white or sort of strong roles of gender, race, and power, and you have them pitted against each other, and you have mirror images. That basically, I think, is what the movie boils down to if you want to talk about any of those aspects. And so I think it's very purposefully done, because you have to construct it like that. Unless he, like I said, lifted the archetypes from somewhere else, you have very strong interplay, and you are basically watching a model, or like a simulation sort of in motion of, let's say we have a woman in charge of a gang, or let's say we have a bunch of men in a cabin and a chained woman, or let's say we have, and I think the audience reaction, I mean, it should be, the audience reaction should be a big part of the study as well, but it is something for the audience, I think, purposefully to look at and to re-examine, hopefully, the way they think about gender and power, and that you can't just assign labels like power and privilege yeah. to race and gender. That's the same race, same gender in every situation. Life and reality and everything is way more flexible than that, way more complex than that. You've got to get out of the black and white thinking, first of all, if you're at all a, you know, a human above 5 years old. But on top of that, you know, sorry, you got to expand your understanding. It's easy and convenient, I know, to blame it all on the patriarchy and to say a dude did it, and to completely ignore the fact that he has a wife to support, or women to attract, or, you know, whatever the fuck, to survive, because there's no shelters or help for him in the society. Either way, nobody looks at that. They just say, oh, a man did a thing and it's bad, I don't like it because it had a woman with a bruise. Yeah, it's time to reassess your privilege, I yeah. think.
And lastly, I will, but we're going to close out. There was an interview that Tarantino did with Variety. And Variety magazine asked him about the violence that was visited upon the woman, you know, in the film. And how, you know, that could be seen as sexist or whatever. And Tarantino said, "Violence is hanging over every one of these characters like a cloak of night. So I'm not going to go, okay, that's the case for 7 of the characters, but because one is a woman, I have to treat her differently. I'm not going to do that." So there it is. That's it in black and white. He basically said, I'm not going to do that because this is the film I want to make, and the everyone's going to have violence. The men get it way worse than she does, but he still, I mean, she still ends up getting killed, and I'm sure hanging is unpleasant. But, you know, she still gets it, you know, and yet people are still don't think it's good enough. Like, she's supposed
to. Well, that's the point. That's the point about equality. Yeah. And the way he phrases it, I think, is very well put, because it highlights the supreme hypocrisy and maybe even, you know, I guess misandry, bigotry, whatever. Mm-hmm. Requiring of special treatment, basically, that a lot of the feminism movement has devolved into. Because he's saying, I will not treat a person differently based on their gender. Isn't that your whole shtick? So, he beautifully puts it that, you know, I'm not going to treat one out of eight people differently because of their gender. And that's exactly what it all boils down to. I mean, ultimately, feminism, and I think I've said this before, but it seems that obviously they're not making a lot of sense anyway, but they have a lot of it is because they have a paradoxical desire. And I don't think they're aware of it because it's a paradox, and maybe like their brains just can't process that paradox, and so it just kind of floats around and dictates their behavior, but they're just never aware of it, some big blind spot. But they want control over everything, and they also want special treatment anytime they want it. So it's not that they're like, treat me equally, because then they get treated equally and they're like, no, I didn't want this. I actually wanted to be treated specially special all the time, special rules all the time, but I don't want you to ever talk about it or to acknowledge it or to ever be aware of it, really, and just say that I'm equal, and say that I'm being treated just like everyone else, and say that absolutely everybody is getting this same thing that I am, but in every single case that I want, I get to be treated specially. So yeah. That, I want that. That's feminism in a nutshell to me.
Yep, pretty much.
At this point.
So, okay, so in closing, I want to open up the floor to you guys who are watching to leave a comment. Maybe if you saw the movie, maybe there's something you caught that we didn't or you want to add to the conversation, please leave a comment and let us know what your thoughts are. I want to thank Anna and Max for taking time to watch The Hateful Eight with me and then discuss it afterwards. And I'm going to close by saying, Old Mary Todd's calling, so I guess it must be time for bed.
That one always gets me.
I don't feel so good. Oh, shit.